ان شاء الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I think we have energy enough now to start ان شاء الله. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Say صلى الله عليه وسلم. One day Imam Ahmad رحمه الله was walking in the street in Damascus. And he was walking with his son Abdullah. And they were dressed in very old clothing. And their slippers were outworn. And his son Abdullah said, Dad, when shall we have comfort? When shall we have ease? And the answer came from Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. He said, with the first step into Jannah. This is where you will find ease in life. This is when you're going to find comfort in life. Brothers and sisters, I can hardly see you because of all of this light on my face now. And I'm freestyle. I'm not going to stand behind the podium. I'm going to ask you, who amongst you have problems in their life? Raise your hand. I can see no hands, mashallah. You have a perfect life, mashallah. Only one hand? I think we have all problems in this life. Yes. And the two main problems that we have in the West today can be summed up in two words, depression and stress. Do you know why? Hello? I like to talk with people. I don't like to talk at people. Do you know why? Do you want me to share with you why? Because we are seeking perfection in something called dunya. And the word dunya in the Arabic language stems from two roots. Dana'ah and dunu'u ajal, which means this life, as the brother was saying, is timed. How long would you live here? The Prophet ﷺ said, أَعْمَارُ أُمَّتِي بَيْنَ السَّتِينَ وَالسَّبْعِينَ لَا يُجَوِزُهَا إِلَّا الْقَلِيلِ. The average span of life of my ummah is between 60 to 70. Very few people who live beyond that. And look at somebody who's above 70 like myself now, everything is aching. No teeth, you know it, right? SubhanAllah. The other stem is dana'a, meaning worthlessness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet, where is Ottawa? The Prophet, he said, لو كانت الدنيا تساوي عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى منها كافر شربة ماء. If this worldly life is equal to a wing of a fly, a wing of a mosquito, Allah wouldn't give a disbeliever a sip of water. But subhanAllah, look today, compare your dunya to the dunya of somebody who next door who is not a Muslim. How many times do we complain from Allah? Lots of times. How many people would say, look at me, I'm a good Muslim, I pray 7 times a day. Sheikh Dawood, do they pray 5 times or 7 times here? Everybody's happy with 7, is that okay? And I have only one boy and he's disabled. My next door neighbors, they're not Muslims, but look at them, they have 4 cars, they have 5 children, and their children have green eyes and green hair. Why me? Do we complain all the time from Allah? That is the problem. Because we are seeking perfection in this dunya. And my question to you is this. Can I have the first slide, please? You live in Ottawa, am I right or right? Right? So after this boring lecture, you're going to get so dumb and you will be very tired and you want to go, give me the word. Say it again. Excellent. So home is Ottawa, right? Home is Ottawa. But you know what? I disagree with you. And look at the first question there. What is real home? Back in the days, we all claim one father and one mother. What's the name of our father? Allahu Akbar, mashallah. I love this guy, this young guy. Where's my candy? I'll give you a candy after we finish. Oh, I have one here. There you go. Oh, you missed? Bring it back. Give it back. Okay. We all have one father. His name is Adam. And we all have one mother. What's her name? Mashallah. They used to live home. What's home for them? Say it again. Jannah, right? They were very happy at home. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned them. He said, you know what? Eat anything you like, but stay away from that tree. And they couldn't. How many trees do we eat from today? Stay away from that tree. That tree is so tempting, right? And Adam and Eve ended up eating from that tree. And they were taken out of home. And they came to the dunya, right? Is that the end? No. Did they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the repentance? Allah told us in the Quran, right? Read in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2 and number 23, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. And Adam received some words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah taught him how to repent. Do you want to know these words? Huh? Yes. Do you want to know those words? Yes. Only five people? I'm sorry. You know, I don't like to talk to dead audience. Do you want to know these words? Yes. Go to Surah Al-A'raf, Surah number 7, ayah number 23. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, these are the words and I want you to say them now. Because we want to go back home. Am I right or right? To the real home. Which is? Not Egypt, young man. Egypt is my temporary home for now, okay? But Jannah is our real home. So we need to do the same thing as Adam alayhi salam did. We need to acknowledge our sins and make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did they say? They said, Rabbana, can you hear this? Say it again. Zalamna anfusana. O our Lord, O our Master, we have wronged ourselves by disobeying you. No exception in this room. وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا. And if you were not to forgive us. وَتَرْحَمْنَا. And shower us with your mercy. لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Indeed, we'll be amongst the losers. So learn these words, but don't use them as lip service. Mean them. Feel them. This is the only way. Now, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, if we go to the first slide, where I ask it, where is real home, or what's real home? He wrote some lines of verse, and I want you to listen to them carefully, because now we're going to build our steps, inshallah, to go back home, real home, which is? Allahu Akbar. He said, لا دار للموت بعد المرء يسكنها. إلا التي كان قبل الموت يبنيها. There is no home for someone that where he will dwell or she will dwell except for the home that you built in this dunya. لا دار للمرء بعد الموت يسكنها إلا التي كان قبل الموت يبنيها. فمن بناها بخير طاب مسكنه. If you build that home with good deeds, you'll have a very nice home. ومن بناها بخير خاب بنيها. And if you build it with bad deeds, this is not going to be a good home for you. فَعْمَلْ لِدَارٍ غَدًا رِضْوَانُ خَازِنُهَا. Work hard for a home where Ridwan is going to be the chief gatekeeper of that home, inshallah, in Jannah. وَالْجَارُ أَحْمَدٍ. And your neighbor will be Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالرَّحْمَانُ نَاشِيهَا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who will build that home for you. Who would like to go home? Not Ottawa. What's home here? Jannah. Now, let me ask you the next question. Can you believe that Jannah is waiting for you, but some people will reject Jannah? Some people will reject Jannah. Who will reject Jannah? Listen to this beautiful hadith collected by Bukhari, rahimahullah, narrated by Abu Hurairah, radiallahu anhu. He said, كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة. All my ummah, all my followers will make it to Jannah. Good news. But then he said, إلا من أبى. Except those who will reject. قيل ومن يأبى يا رسول الله. Who would that person who would reject that offer to go to Jannah? قال من أطاعني دخل الجنة. He says, whoever obeys me will make it back home safely to Jannah. ومن عصاني فقد أبى. and whoever disobeys me, he's rejecting Jannah. So what is the way to Jannah, brothers and sisters? Say it again. Obedience of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you obey the messenger, by default, you're obeying the one who sent him with the message. Do you agree with me or agree? Hello, am I right or right? Egyptian democracy, mashallah. Okay, now, next. Do you know the story of the first one who will make it to Jannah? Okay, somebody's challenging me here. Okay. It's Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. According to the hadith, he said, أنا أول من يدخل الجنة. I'll be the first one to make it to Jannah. فأمسق بحلق بابها. I'm going to hold the doorknobs of the gates of Jannah. فأقعقعها. And I'm going to knock on the door. فيقال لي من خلف الباب. You know, they will ask from behind the gates, من? Who? And I'm going to say, Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. And they will say, بك أمرنا ألا نفتح لأحد قبلك. We have instructions not to open the gates of Jannah for anyone before you. Then I will enter and whoever is going to enter after me. Brothers and sisters, do you want to know the story of the last one who will make it to Jannah? Nobody's interested. Let's move on. Okay. You want to know? Oh, that's a very late yes. You have to wait patiently till the end of my presentation, inshallah. Or maybe Sister Loreen might intercede for you. Should I share it with them now? Okay. Jazakallah khair. Okay. The story is in Sahih Muslim. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, the Prophet ﷺ shared with me the story of the last man who will make it to Jannah. He said, it will be a man who will be in hellfire. And imagine somebody in hellfire for some time. And when he comes out, he's going to be limping and he's going to be falling. And he will look behind and he would say, there is no one on earth who has been blessed with a blessing better than me now, just by being saved from hellfire. Brothers and sisters, if I take you back to the Quran, Surah number 3, Surah Al-Imran, Ayah number 185, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كل نفس ذائقة الموت. Every single soul will taste death. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ. Whoever will be saved from hellfire, وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ. And he'll be allowed to enter Jannah. What's the end? فَقَدْ فَاز. This is success. This is real success. وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. All what you see of the pleasures of this worldly life is nothing but delusion. You heard Sister Hala, mashallah, before me, she was saying, our main focus is this life. We forget about the real life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, in Surah number 29, Al-Ankabut, Ayah number 64, Allah talks about two lives. وَمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَهُ وَلَعِبُ. This worldly life is nothing but playing an amusement. And then he said, وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. And the real life is the hereafter, if they really know. So where's the real life? Who's stating this fact? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our final destination is, our main focus should be, so that man, after he comes out of hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise a tree in front of him. Underneath that tree there is some water, and now he has been in hellfire for a long time. So when he sees the tree, he's going to say, Ya Allah, can I just get close to that tree? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to say, if I take you to that tree, would you promise not to ask me for anything else? And the man says, yes, I will never ask you for anything else. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring him closer to that tree. And once the man is under the shade of the tree, and he drinks from the water, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to raise another tree that's bigger, lushier, with nice water underneath it. The man looks at that tree and he's going to say, only this one. Then Allah is going to say, didn't you promise if I were to bring you closer to the first one, you're not going to ask for anything more? But Allah knows he has been through a lot in hellfire. So Allah is going to bring him closer to the second tree. Once he's there, Allah is going to raise a third tree, which is bigger and lashier. And the man sees it and he's going to say, again. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take him to that tree. Guess what? Where is he now? He's right in front of the gates of Jannah. Home. Sweet home. Then he's going to look inside. He's going to say, can I enter here? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to say, would you be happy if I allow you in Jannah and give you the kingdom of one king in the dunya? No, two, three, four, five. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches five, the man is going to say, أَتَهْزَأُ بِي وَأَنْتَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Are you making fun of me and you are the master of the universe? Allah is going to say, لا أهزأ بك. I'm not making fun of you. ولكني على ما أشاء قادر. If I want something, and I would say be, it is. Brothers and sisters, this is the last one who will make it back home. Would you like to make it back home? Safe? This is why the next question of today is this. We want to go back home, right? Before we do this, I might ask you, what is the ultimate goal of your life? Some of you are teenagers like me. Who is 16, my age and below? Raise your hands. MashaAllah. Excellent. Okay. What is your ultimate goal in life? To join university? Okay. Those who are in their 20s, who are at university, what's your ultimate goal? To graduate? Those who are like right after that, young professionals, what's your ultimate goal? To have a dream house and to make some money, to be a millionaire? And somebody's like, astaghfirullah, a Muslim and a millionaire? What is wrong with that? Some people always think if you are a good Muslim, then you have to be poor, inshallah. Who said that? Uthman radiallahu an made it to Jannah through his millions. Stop that concept. Okay, so what could be our ultimate dreams? Could it be good education? Say yes or yes. Excellent. Could it be being a millionaire, having lots of money? Excellent. Could it be a dream house? Excellent. Those who are not married, those who are not married, raise your hands. Anybody who's not married here? Shame on you. What are you waiting for? I think we have matrimonial service. We'll match you, inshallah, before you go home, inshallah. Okay, next question. So it could be your ultimate goal now is to get a beautiful wife or a handsome husband. Am I right or right? Now, the question is, these are halal goals. Say yes or yes. But if Jannah is your ultimate goal, would your choice be affected in all of these choices? Say yes or yes. It will, and I'm going to prove it to you right now. And I'm going to claim my candy back. Okay, here's the question. If Jannah is my ultimate goal, would it affect my choice when it comes to choosing my spouse? Say yes or yes. Yeah, if Jannah is out of the equation, you'll go for the beauty. Am I right or right? Just be honest. Be honest. Right? And I'm going to give you a real example right now. You know, I teach a class called Engagement Before Encagement. Marriage in Islam from A to Z. Okay? And we talk about everything and the problems in marriages and practically speaking, how can we get over them? In one of the slides, I just stole this one here. Let me ask you this question. When a man is seeking a woman for marriage, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us there are four criteria. You know them? تُنْكَحِ الْمَرْأَى لِأَرْبَعْ لِجَمَالِهَا for her beauty وَلِمَالِهَا for her wealth وَلِحَسَبِهَا وَنَسَبِهَا for her family or lineage ولدينها, and for her practice of the deen, right? What did the Prophet ﷺ recommend at the end? He said, فَظْفَرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ تَرِبَتْ يَدَاكَ. Marry the one with the religion. And subhanAllah, I had a friend, one of my students, who used to live in Ottawa back in the days when I was teaching at the University of Calgary. And he told me, Dr. Rida, I found the sister, alhamdulillah. But I have a problem. I said, what's the problem? He said, she has very good deen, mashallah, but unfortunately, she's beautiful. And I'm like, what? Unfortunately, she's beautiful? He said, yeah, the Prophet ﷺ said, marry the one with the deen. I said, he didn't say marry the one with the deen, but she must be ugly. That's how some people sometimes think, right? So, if the deen is there, can we go back to the slide, please? If the deen is there, if you have a look there, I don't know if this one is working, okay. You see that 1,000? So if the deen is there, put one. So what's our first priority? The deen, right? So if the deen is there, priority number one is there, write one. Is that clear? If she's beautiful, add a zero. That's a bonus. It will become 10. What if she's wealthy? Alhamdulillah. Add another zero. It will make it 100. What if she comes from a good family? Add a third zero, mashallah. It will make it 1,000. Take the one out, which is the deen. You end up with? No, three zeros. How many of you are living with three zeros? Because Jannah was not there when you choose your spouse. Am I right or right? See me after the conference, inshallah. Okay, next. So the question of today is, the question of tonight or today is, I want to make it to Jannah. Do you want to make it to Jannah? Raise your hand. Astaghfirullah. One hand? Astaghfirullah. Only two hands? I wish I had 10. Excellent. So think about it. I want you to be serious. So we want to go to Jannah. Say it out loud. We want Jannah. Excellent. So how can I do it? The question is, who should I ask? Who should I model? Who should be my example? You know what? How can I measure that I'm walking towards my destination? Next would be, you know what? What about going to ask the 10 that were promised Jannah? There's an authentic hadith where the Prophet ﷺ mentioned 10 people by name. He said, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar ibn al-Khattab fil Jannah, Uthman fil Jannah, Ali fil Jannah, عبد الرحمن بن عوف في الجنة, سعد بن أبي وقاص في الجنة, الزبير بن العوام في الجنة, أبو عبيدة بن الجراح في الجنة, سعيد بن زيد في الجنة. There is one missing. I have the candy. الزبير بن العوام في الجنة. I'll keep the candy. 10 in one hadith. Should we ask them, inshallah? Say yes or yes. But we have a problem. They passed away. They're dead. Okay, what about the alternative? Next. You know what? Can we study their biography? Why should we do this? Move to the next slide. Why should we reinvent the wheel? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the recipe. Why did I use the word recipe? Because we need to know the ingredients of what it takes to book my ticket to Jannah. And the reason I use the word recipe, because when we brothers are invited by another brother, and after you eat the biryani, and you cannot move to pray Isha, mashallah, then the dessert comes. And the dessert is a very nice cheesecake. And when you eat the cheesecake, you like it so much. But you will feel embarrassed to go and ask the sister who made it, right? So you go to the brother and say, brother, can you ask your wife to tell my wife the recipe for that cheesecake? Because we want to make it at home. So please ask her for the ingredients. Do you want to know the ingredients and the recipe for making it to Jannah? Only 5 people, shame on you. What's happening to Ottawa? You know, would you like to know the recipe? Sister, do you think this is enough energy? One more time. Do you want to know the recipe to Jannah?
Yes.
Let's go for the next slide. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the recipe. You know it. You read it. But you never stop to know how to book your ticket to Jannah. If you go to Surah Al-Mu'minun, Surah number 23, read the ayat from 1 to 11. The recipe is there. Let's go through it quickly, inshallah, and end up. What's the recipe? The recipe is this ayat. If you go to Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, next slide, inshallah, next slide.
قَدْ يَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ
Allahu Akbar. This is like flashback. Allah is using the word قَدْ الَّتِي تُفِيدِ التَّحْقِيقِ which means for sure. For sure. And it's used with a verb in the past. أَفْلَحَ means whoever is going to apply all these ingredients, they are guaranteed success. قَدْ يَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ Who are they? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الْمُؤْمِنُونَ the true believers. Let's go quickly into the ingredients. Number one,
الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون.
They are those who focus in their salah. Listen carefully. Why didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say الذين يصلون أو الذين يؤدون الصلاة? Because as Muslims, we have to pray. It's taken for granted. But sometimes you ask some Muslims today, when was the last time you prayed, brother? He's going to say, hold on, about 8 months ago, Salat al-Eid. Are there Muslims who do this? Yeah, there are. Let's be real. It could be my brother or your brother. Some people will say, oh, you mean Jum'ah. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not talking about that level. Right? Allah is talking about you pray 5 times a day. But the question is, Salah without khushu' is like a body without a soul. So Allah's talking about the essence of salah. Brothers and sisters, the word salah in Arabic stems from the root salah, which means connection. How many of us pray 5 times a day and we never establish connection with Allah? Shall I tell you how we pray? Shall I?
Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.
Is that biryani in the kitchen? Oh, anyway.
Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim.
The Kaaba. You know what? Last time when I went to Umrah, I'm not going to forgive that brother who stepped on my toes. Man, like I still have my nail there. Okay. Inshallah, when I go next time, I'm going to deal with him.
Malik Yawm al-Din.
What am I going to do next? I have an assignment. Oh, I hate that professor, man. I hate him. I don't think I'm going to pass this, you know. Anyway.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم.
What type of colors in this prayer mat? Green and red? They don't match. Anyway, who cares?
ولا الضالين.
And you come to the end of the salah, you want to do like السلام. Did I pray 3 or 4? Allah غفور رحيم. Allah doesn't need my salah. Isn't this the way we pray? So Allah's talking about the first ingredient. If you want to make it to Jannah, you need to have khushu' in your salah. You need to establish a connection with Allah in salah because salah without connecting with Allah is exactly like a phone with no signal, brothers and sisters. How many times you pick up the phone and you push the number that you want to dial and it keeps saying, dialing, connecting, connecting, and then the line drops. Why? Because there is no signal. How many times do we say Allahu Akbar? We do not connect. You ask a brother or sister, how do you feel after salah? They say perfectly like before salah. And I'm saying, perfect exercise, brothers and sisters. You just went down and up and that's it. No. You need to connect with Allah. So what's ingredient number one, inshallah, to make it to Jannah? Khushu' in salah. Salah without khushu' is useless. Is that clear? Number two. Allah says in the next ayah,
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ
The next one. Hold this. The Prophet ﷺ extended his tongue one day and he said, hold this. When a Sahabi came to me and said, Prophet of Allah, give me advice. He said, أَمْسِكْ عَلَيْكَ لِسَانَكَ Hold your tongue. Why? لا يكب الناس على وجوههم في النار سوى حصائد ألسنتهم. Nothing will be the reason for people to be grabbed on their faces to hellfire except the harvest of their tongues. Brothers and sisters, do you know the challenge of the brothers in this dunya? Do you know the biggest fitna? Do you know it, brothers? Women. Am I right or right? That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. That's what Allah said in the Quran. Go to 3 Al-Imran, ayah number 14. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, at the top of the list of the fitna for the people, He said, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. He mentioned women on the top. Am I right or right? Yeah, there would be a problem if you say no. Let's move here. What's your biggest fitna? Sisters? And the brothers will do like this. No, it's not you. What's your biggest fitna? Holding that tongue. Holding that tongue. Is that clear? This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. The next ingredient, if you want to book your ticket to Jannah, is stay away from vain talk. Brothers and sisters, we commit major sins every day. How many times do we say, it's a white lie? Who told you that lies have colors? It's a lie. The phone rings, right? And this is how we act. This is why some people come to me and they say, you know, Dr. Rida, my son is a professional liar. I don't know where did he learn lying? And I'm going to tell you where he learned lying. At home. Because when the phone rings, you look at the phone and say, oh. Then the kid is innocent. He's going to say, what do you mean that? It's like, hold on, uncle. I don't know. Like, my dad is doing something weird here. Let me check. What do you mean? It's like, stupid. Tell him I'm not here. It's like, oh, okay. Uncle, my dad is telling you he's not here. Isn't that real? He's a kid. He doesn't know lying, but you're teaching him how to lie. You're using your tongue, right? How many times do we tell our kids, listen, do not backbite people. And you're sitting in the dinner table and you say, did you see that sister in the conference and the way she was dressed? And then your son is going to say, Dad, you told us in the morning, this is backbiting. It's like, no, this is plus 18. We can do it. You can. No. What's haram for you is haram for them. Am I right or right? Yeah. So hold your tongue. If it is good, say it. If it's bad, stop it. So stay away from vain talk. Number 3.
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ.
Allah said, after talking about connecting in salah, holding your tongue, He said, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ. How many of you speak Arabic here? Raise your hands. I'm going to embarrass you. Be careful. Oh, hands are down now, mashallah. Okay, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ? Usually when the word zakah comes, it's always يُؤْتِ الزَّكَاةِ, right? But why would Allah say, فَاعِلُونَ? Do we نَفْعَ لِلزَّكَاةِ? Because the word zakah is not in the literal meaning of zakah here. Zakah in the Arabic language stems from two roots. يُزَكِّي means to purify. يُزَكِّي also means to develop or cause something to grow. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you have to do zakah of two things, yourself and your money. Purify your money from ill gain by giving zakah and giving charity. And purify yourself. قَدْ يَأَفْلَحَ مَنْ The same word. قَدْ يَأَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. So you need to develop yourself and move and better your character until you become a better Muslim. So this is ingredient number 3. So number 1 is, you're not going to go home without mastering the ingredients to book your ticket to Jannah, inshallah. Number 1 is, mastering your salah by khushu', right? Number 2 is, hold your tongue. Say good or be silent. Number 3 is, better yourself and purify your money from ill gain by giving zakah and giving charity. Number 4, Allah said,
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ حَافِظُونَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى وَرَاءَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْعَادُونَ.
Basically, Allah is talking about one and only one legal relationship between a man and a woman, which is marriage. So basically Allah is saying chastity. The only legal relationship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a desire within the man towards the woman. Allah created a desire within the woman towards the man. The only way to satisfy this is through marriage. We Muslims, alhamdulillah, we love dates. It's a sunnah to eat them in the morning. But we never date. Do you agree with me or agree? Remember the democracy all the time, okay? Okay, so number four in the ingredients is, give me one word, chastity. So, did you forget number one? Khushu' and salah. Number two? Oh my God, they forgot. Hold your tongue. Number three? Zakah of yourself and your money. Number four? Chastity. Move on to the last but one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ.
Basically, you have to be trustworthy. If somebody trusts you, if somebody were to trust you with something or with even information or secrets, you have to be trustworthy. Never disclose the information and give the trust back. Because Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who led by example, left Ali radiallahu anhu in Mecca when he immigrated. Why? Not only to sleep in his bed, but to give the trusts back to the people of Quraysh. Even though they are forcing him out of his home, yet he left somebody to give them their trusts back. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, addu al-amanat ila ahliha. Give the trust back to the people who trusted you with. One part also of this one, Allah said, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَعَهْدِهِمْ. If you sign a contract, if you sign a covenant, if you sign an agreement, you have to honor it. You have to follow the conditions there. Don't say, you know what, this is a kafir. You know, I don't have to be committed with him. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the very beginning of Surah Al-Ma'idah, number 5, ayah number 1, He said,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا.
Say, نَعَمْ يَا رَبْ. Say, yes, Allah. I wish to be a true believer. Allah said, أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. Honor the covenants. Honor the contracts. If you sign something, just to honor it. The last one, the last ingredient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ.
Allahu Akbar. Where did Allah start? Allah started with salah, right? And He's ending up again with salah. Why? Have you ever asked yourself, brothers and sisters? You know, salah is the main pillar of this deen. As-salatu amudu ad-deen, right? Subhanallah. What does that mean? After you become a Muslim through the shahada, all the other pillars of Islam, you know what? You can be exempted from them. What do you mean by that? You can be exempted from siyam if you're too old to fast, or if you're too sick to fast. You can only give the fidyah. If you are poor, you don't have enough money, you don't have the nisab, you don't have to give zakah. You're exempted. In fact, you might even receive zakah. What about hajj? If you are not physically or financially able, you are exempted. But what about salah? You can never stop salah, even if you are on the deathbed. Because salah is the connection with Allah. How can you live without having a connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, you need to know the last ingredient is, Allah said, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. There is another aspect after khushu'. Here Allah is talking about two things. You pray on time, and you are consistent in your salah. You don't pray just Eid. You don't only pray Jumu'ah. You pray 5 times a day. If you love Allah, would you like to connect with Him? If a king invites you to his house 5 times a day, how happy would you be? What about the King of all kings when he says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. When you hear this, how do you feel? Allahu Akbar, akhi. Allah is the greatest. No. It means Allah is greater than anything you are doing. Leave it and come. Accept the invitation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you don't hear this, no, towards the end of the adhan, it says, Hayya ala salah. If the implicit invitation by saying Allahu Akbar, come, Allah is greater than what you're doing. Allah says, come to salah. Why? حَيَّ عَلَى الْفَلَاحِ قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ This is your ticket to Jannah. Come because your success is going to be in salah. So let me conclude with this. The last slide, you know, let's summarize the ingredients for the recipe to book your ticket to Jannah. Number one is, I want everybody to say with me, خُشُوعَ in salah. Number two, hold your tongue. Number three, zakah. And zakah applies to yourself and to your money. Number four, chastity. Stay away from haram. I'm going to get you a wife. Don't worry, inshallah. Number five, be trustworthy and honor your promises and covenants. And the last one, when the Prophet ﷺ was asked, ما أحب الأعمال إلى الله. What's the most beloved act of worship to Allah? He said, الصلاة على وقتها. To pray on time and to be consistent in your salah. I'm sorry, I'm a teacher by profession. So now you go home mastering the ingredients of booking your ticket to Jannah. Do you know how to book your ticket to Jannah now? Let's have the last slide. And I'm out of here. No, more. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. One more. No. Man, you spoiled it. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.